Today on Junior's Lead On, eHook Projects number 5, where I show you how to take one of these and turn it into a functional magnetometer. So what is a magnetometer? It's a device that allows you to check out different properties of magnetic fields and magnets. So if I turn the magnetometer on, we can see the north and the south pole. That's pretty cool. Check out some other magnets. So this one has multiple poles on the surface, as well, you can check out other ones as well. This will also detect alternating magnetic fields. So what I have here is I have a magnet that I can spin around. And if I spin it fast enough, we can see that there's a little green light that also comes on. And this just shows us that there's a moving magnetic field. And we see the red and the blue come on as well and alternate as we get closer to the magnet. So, yeah, that's cool. Check out some other alternating magnetic fields. In the plasma pen, we can detect the magnetic field of the actual inductor and transformer. So here we go. And also in one of the Ihuka Tesla coils, we can also do the same thing. We can also detect those fields in consumer items as well as just regular magnetic fields. So for example, in the speakers, we can detect the speakers. We can also detect the electromagnetic or more so magnetic components inside of the device as well. So here's an inductor in that area. Seems to be another one in that area. I think that's all there is. But it'll also pick up the sound from the speakers. Pretty cool. It'll also work for other things. So on my universal battery charger, it'll also pick up the alternating magnetic fields inside of that. So this is a really cool handy gizmo to have. And in this video, I'm going to show you how to build one. Let's check out all the things that we need to build it. You'll need a small plastic tube, 6 to 7 millimeters in width. A small electromagnetic coil. This I got from a 5-volt stepper motor. An LM386. A pair of unipolar Hall effect sensors, a 50-50 SMD RGB LED, a few capacitors of which to set the gain for your circuit, and a bunch of small wires, a JS connector for charging your eHooka, a DPAK style N-channel MOSFET, a 1/8 watt resistor anywhere from 1 to 10K, a Schottky diode, a 5mm momentary tactile push button switch, and a bunch of SMT resistors of various values. Of course, you'll also need an eHooka. In the first eHookas project video, I showed you how to make a battery adapter and how to take apart an eHooka. For this project, from the eHooka, you'll need the thin tube, the battery, and the little microphone piece that senses the air pole. You'll be needing the little LED from it for a power on indicator. Let's get started with making the sensor head. To start with your sensor head, you'll be taking your 2 unipolar Hall effect sensors and gluing them back to back. You'll be gluing them in a configuration like this. So let's do that. Get some super glue out. And just simply glue them together. Just like that. After you're done gluing together your two unipolar Hall effect sensors together, you'll be bending the wires in this configuration. You'll see both of the positives are close to one another. Both of the negatives in the middle are close to one another. And the two output signal wires are still separated. So we'll be putting four wires on, one wire for the positive, one wire for the negative, and one blue wire for the south pole detection, and one red wire for the north pole detection. Go ahead and do that. Let's start off with the tinning of the little pieces. So the two grounds. Two positives. And the two sensor wires. Now let's attach those wires. So I'm going to start again with the ground wire. So black wire. I'm using this white and red wire for the positive to my sensor unit. I'll be using a blue wire for my south pole magnetic detection, which will be the Hall effect sensor that has the product number facing down. So it'll be the Hall effect sensor on the top. So this guy. And then I'll be using a red wire for my north pole detection, which will be the Hall effect sensor with the numbers facing up. And this is what you should have. Bad eyesight, apparently. That's not very helpful, is it? Right. Now it's time for the little electromagnetic coil and the small piece of tubing to make the coil that will be used to detect alternating magnetic fields. First, you want to find one end of the little magnetic wire and start to unspool it. I believe it's this end right here. Give me your wires. There you go. You're going to want to save a little bit on the end. So what I do is I wrap up a little bit, stick it into the tube. After that, I'm going to make a small slit just in the tube. Try to put my little coil of wire in it. Well, that doesn't seem to work. So we use super glue instead. Give it a little spritz with this. And then we start wrapping the wire. Super glue is helpful in this. So you want two layers, that is all you need, and wrap it nice and tightly. So we're gonna push that wire down. Okay, and now we take off the extra wire. Does not hurt to coat the whole coil. Just a very fine coat of super glue does the trick. Perfect. Now, carefully cut off the excess plastic on the tube. I'm going to use a Dremel for that. But first, I'm going to poke the extra coil out so I don't accidentally cut it. Smart thinking. that'll work quite nice. Let's solder some wires to that. For the coil, I have yellow and orange that I'll be soldering onto it. So first I'm going to tin both these wires and I'm going to prepare the coil. Let's get on the tinning. Hotter. Yeah, let's start with these first. Now, what I like to do is to very carefully wrap the coil around, or sorry, wrap the wire around the other wire, just like this. So I'm gonna grab a little bit of coil. And I'm just gonna wrap it around, so, just like this. And then just solder it into position. Now you need to let it soak in a little bit because it does need to burn off the enamel on the magnet wire. You're gonna wanna make sure it's good and silver, the whole thing. And then repeat the same process with the yellow wire. With that done, there should be just enough room in your coil for your two unipolar Hall effect sensors to fit right in. Looks good. Let's test the coil continuity. I hear you. Looks good. Now that we have both the static and alternating magnetic sensors assembled, we can put them together in one unit. So to do that, I'm going to take and clip the orange wire a little shorter, leaving about half an inch exposed. And then I'm going to prepare to solder that. Now that wire will be connected to the ground of the unipolar Hall effect sensor assembly. So very carefully connect those together. Let's check out how that looks. That ground wire came off a little bit. That looks better. I have to make sure that those aren't touching. Looks good. Just to make sure, a little super glue over that. now it's time to put the Hall Effect sensors inside of the little pickup coil. You're going to want to center them in so it's sticking out on the bottom. And now with a hot glue gun, screw them into position. So, very simply. And here we have the complete module itself. Other wire, north pole, south pole, ground, and pickup coil. Let's wire up the 5050 RGB LED. I have a 75 ohm resistor for the green that goes on the anode. And I have a 220 ohm resistor that goes on the cathode of the red. I also have a 150 ohm resistor that goes on the cathode of the blue. Let's get to soldering those on. On my LED, the key right here is the positive of the blue. And this side right here is the negative of the green. So the first LED will go on right here, just being the 75 ohm. Next, the 220 ohm on the cathode of the red LED. And finally, the 150 ohm on the cathode of the blue LED. Here's what the back of the LED should look like when you're finished with it. Now that the LED is prepared, let's hook it up to the magnetic sensor assembly. So I'm going to get a green wire for the green LED, and I'm going to tin the end of that. This will go on to the 75 ohm resistor on the green LED. Focus. Technology these days. Oh gosh. Cool. Let's start that green wire on to the 75 ohm resistor on the green LED. That complete. Let's move on to the positive wire on this. So I want to take a little section. And just expose some wire in the center. That'll work. This positive wire will connect to both the positive for the red and the blue LEDs. So these two right here. Next, it's time to take your red wire and connect that up to the resistor on your red LED. Now it's time to connect the blue wire up to the 150 ohm resistor for the blue LED. Ooh, looks okay. Well, let's test it. Magnet. Positive. Negative. Pole detection seems to work. And North Pole seems to work. Oh, that went effortlessly so far. Right. And then the last one to connect up is the negative or the green. Let's go ahead and do that. And hope nothing breaks in the process. And let's give the green a test. I gotta strip the green. And we're good. Well, if you made it this far, it's time to super glue that back of the LED because you don't want any of those little parts falling apart on you now. After you're done wiring up the LED to the sensor head, it also helps to glue the LED into position on the sensor head itself, and then to check and make sure that the whole thing fits effortlessly into the tube, which it does. At this point, you can get your LM386 and prepare that. So first, we're going to start with the two ground connections. The two ground connections are going to be pin 2 and pin 4. So those are going to need to be bridged. Now I'm going to start by trimming the leads off the pins. And then I'm going to locate pins 2 and 4 and bend them down. Just like that. So you already have some ground wire, negative wire on here. So I'm going to be connecting the black wire to those two pins. I'm going to start by stripping off some of the coating in two locations. And I find that giving the wire a little twist during this helps immensely. Okay. Now to get two little points of solder on each one of those and solder those on. And then over to the next one. The pin between those two points is going to be your input pin. So the green wire coming from your AC sense coil, alternating magnetic sense coil, is going to be going to pin 3. Now I'm going to shorten down pin 3 and we'll connect the green wire to it. Looks good. Oh no, that's our output wire. What am I talking about? The yellow is our input wire. That's okay because our output wire happens to be pin 5, so that'll be really close by. Yellow wire goes to input from the coil, which is pin 3. Now all we need is a positive and to set the capacitor. So the positive is going to be this pin right here, which is pin 6. And we do not need pin 7. So for the time being, I'm just going to lift that one up out of the way. So for the positive connection, we're going to need to add some wire onto that as well. That'll go to the battery. So let's do that. And that'll go all to pin 6. So I think the last pin, pin 6 here, and fold that down and in, and then we'll be soldering right to it. Looks good. This is what I've got so far. All right, let's hook a capacitor up to it and see what we get. So I'm going to start off with a 3.3 microfarad. And the capacitor goes opposite of the polarity. So the side with the positive wire, the negative side goes on. So, see, positive connection, negative side. So this way. Let's see what we get with this value. And this capacitor goes between pins 1 and 8 on the LM386. So just like this. Let's give it a quick test. I have my battery charger here. Let's go and connect up positive to the positive and negative to the negative and see if we get anything on the green LED. And sure enough, it's picking it up. And that LED flashing right there is actually what's coming off the charger. Looks good so far. Now that looks pretty nice. So all I've done now is glued the wires onto the bottom of the IC, and I have switched the location of the capacitor. I've also substituted the 3.3 microfarad with a 10 microfarad, just for a little bit more sensitivity on the alternating magnetic field detection coil. And let's make sure it fits in the tube all nice and easily, which it does. It's perfect. So now on to making the switch. What you'll need for that is a switch, a MOSFET, a small Schottky diode, and that 1/8 watt resistor, anywhere from 1 kilo ohm to 10 kilo ohm. I'm using a 4.7 kilo ohm for mine. Let's prepare some of the parts. So we're going to be preparing the switch first, and to do that, you want to make the bottom just a little bit more thin. Carefully spread those legs out, and then I'm going to be using my Dremel to take off some of the plastic on the bottom, make sure it's all smooth. Looks good. On the MOSFET, you're going to want to make sure that it's also free of any solder if it's used. So I'm going to be taking the solder carefully off the bottom, which is the drain of the MOSFET. So looking at the MOSFET, we have the drain tab, which is also shared with the middle connection here, and we have the source, and we have the gate. Simple. So right now I am going to glue this onto the switch. So I'm going to put a little bit of glue right here on the bottom. And actually, you know, I'm also going to do a few things as well. That'll be fine. I'm going to straighten out these two tabs on the bottom just a little bit, and I'm going to carefully get rid of the little tab in the center. Now I can glue this switch on. Just like that. Pretty simple. Now, on the one side of the MOSFET where the source is, you're going to leave it alone. On the one side with the gate, you're going to want to save this side of the switch. So, what you're going to do is you're going to bend it up towards the gate pin. So, it's just up a little bit like that. The other pin on that side, you can just simply cut off. You won't be using that. And this pin over here, we won't be using as well. So we'll just get rid of that one. Very simple. Let's take and fold that white one right over, just like that. For the time being. Now, with your 1/8 watt resistor, simply make sure the legs are as straight as possible. And it's going to be soldered between the two legs here of the MOSFET. And this side will also be joining the switch as well. And then on the source, connect the other side of the resistor up. Very nice, very nice. Now let's make sure it fits into the tube. Looks good. Now here's that Schottky diode. You want to take and prepare to connect the cathode of the Schottky diode up to the MOSFET drain. So for this, I'm going to take and bend it down smooth against the diode on the side. Just like this. And then this will be soldered onto the MOSFET drain. Just like that. Let's do that. I'm going to tin the MOSFET drain. Now, I like to try to add the power LED right up on top of this Schottky diode. So for that, I'm going to first trim a little bit off the top of the Schottky diode. That should do quite nicely. And then I'm going to take the other leg, and I'm going to remove a little bit of the MOSFET drain right here with the Dremel. You'll see why. Just like that, to make a little bit more clearance for the other leg of the MOSFET, or sorry, other leg of the Schottky diode, as it goes underneath the MOSFET. And then this is where the negative for the circuit is going to be connected to. So eventually, this negative wire gets connected up to that. But looks good so far. Onto that pesky little LED. So here's one of the more difficult things. I've already got pulled a 220 ohm resistor. And now I've got to get that little LED from the microphone sensor. Gotcha. Here's the resistor that I pulled and the LED from the Ihuga microphone sensor. As you see, they are quite small. The Wooby, soldering those together. I've got a little black surface here with some double-sided tape. Let's see how this works. The tape fairy. And I'm gonna put the LEDs, sorry, I'm gonna put the LED and resistor face down on the tape. So there's the LED. And we're gonna negotiate the resistor right next to the LED in the, so if you want it. Time to solder. Now to apply some wires onto that, we're going to take some of the coil from the electromagnetic coil and put two wires, one wire on each side. Let's get some of the magnet wire, tin the end of it. And I'm going to tin about actually half an inch or so. Maybe a little bit more in total. You can also use bare copper wire for this as well if it's thin enough. And repeat the same process on the other side. Now let's test it. See if it works. Try the other way. Dead battery. Excellent. Let's see, we can note polarity as well at this point then. Okay, positive is resistor side. Cool. So we're going to glue it on top of the diode very carefully, with the positive side towards this end of the switch. We're going to let this whole part set and then join it to the rest of the sensor head. Now that the glue has dried on the LED assembly on top of the Schottky diode, I did one thing and just changed where the lead was on this resistor so that it was closer to the positive coming off that switch. That way, when the switch is activated, it sends power to the positive side of the LED. And the negative gets it from the negative side, sorry, the anode side of the Schottky diode. So let's connect those two connections up. At this point, we should be able to test it. I'm going to do so by connecting up the positive to the positive lead, which I'm using the more red side on this wire, and then the negative to the MOSFET source. So this guy, and this guy. That's not the result I was expecting. Oh, there it goes. On, off. Cool. I think this is ready to attach to our sensor module. So we got this short black wire here, and this is what's going to be attaching to the Schottky diode on the switch assembly. We're going to cut that so it's a fair bit shorter. And then solder that on. Trim those wires down. Perfecto. Now trim the other side. There's going to be a positive connection made to this. You want to keep a little bit sticking out still. Make sure that this fits in the tube. New plan. You want to leave none of that sticking out. We're going to carefully strip a little piece in the middle of the red wire. In it to win it, and then very carefully so it's not making any contact with that little diode connection, solder it right here. Now, the last wire. So we're going to get a longer section of the black wire, like this. Jesus Christ, this is tangled up. And now for a section of longer black wire, which will be the last wire we'll be putting on. And this will be for negative input. And this attaches to the MOSFET source. Bada bing, bada boom. Should be done. Go ahead and test it out. Negative. Positive. No smoke. The light. What have I done wrong? Oh, that switch is just stiff. I see. Well, it works at least. Let's test it on a magnet. And the AC sense side. Well, that's not promising. Oh, yeah, I see it. Little green light. Because the battery is fully charged. I think this battery is dead. Well, ironically, I have a fully charged one, so. LED's a fair bit more responsive, that's for sure. Hey, there we go. Perfecto, 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 perfecto. That is very nice looking. I do believe it's time to complete this e-hookah project. So the first step you're going to want to do is strip a little bit of the negative wire right here. And let's see if it fits in the tube before you connect the battery up to it. Oh, perfect. That is nice. Very nice. The section that we just stripped right here, we're going to be connecting it to the negative end of the battery. So, negative side. Now, connector up. A little dab of hot glue. Now, for safety reasons, I am going to cut the end of the black wire off just so it doesn't short out while connecting up the positive. So the wires are best fit along this little area. So I'm going to manage the wires in to fit a little bit better. So just like that. And then run the positive up. So strip it right about there, that section. Yeah, that'll work. I'm also going to cut the spare off the positive. Cool. Alright. Very carefully line the wires up and connect up the positive connection to the battery. Looks good. A little bit of a little bit of hot glue between those areas probably help as well. Get off. Okay, you know, the clean side of the tube, or start off with. And then carefully insert everything into the tube. So the last thing to do is the charge connectors. So the first step to do is to take the corners off the GS connector. Very simple to do. Give those a little clean up too. So I find that it's best to solder this part with it on a plug, just because it helps hold the pins in the proper place, and it also tells you the polarity as well of your adapter right away, so you don't have to worry about doing any of the wires wrong. And so there, I'm just going to now shorten these two wires and solder those onto the connector here. Perfect. And now, since these are both live on the battery, I'm gonna be very careful with soldering these connections together. Final assembly time. Da-da-da-da. So all that's left to do is to kind of clean out any residual glue that might be in there. But there it is. I mean, it's done. It's good to go. In the previous e-hookah videos, I also showed you how to use a capacitor as a little end cover for the charging terminal on the back of your e-hookah device. But now that you've built your e-hookah magnetometer, you can go ahead and check out different magnetic fields in different things. And it's a really cool, really handy device to have. Let's see. AC detection. Works like a charm. Let's try on here. Perfect. The magnetometer is a practical tool to have for diagnostics. Let's go ahead and check out my dusty computer. Power supply. Fan looks good. Oh, a little bit of green. Oh, that's definitely not the fan. Something's noisy in there. Check the graphics cards. They look pretty clean. I expected more. Let's check out the motherboard inductors here. Oh yeah, lighting up a little bit already. Check the one above it. Oh yeah, got some good signal off that one out. There's another one. Nice. But does detect inductors and stuff on circuit boards, make sure that they're working no problem. So a very handy tool if you're going to check out magnetic components on different circuit boards. Here's another magnetometer that I am working on, and this one has a little bit of an update, just so you guys know you can do a little bit more with this project. It actually has a little speaker inside of it, so you can hear the alternating magnetic fields. Let's give a demonstration of that. We'll just pick up some of the sound coming from here real quick. So we'll listen to some of the other electromagnetic fields. Go see what other things sound like. The magnetometer is one of the best things that I've ever built using the eHookah form factor, and it's a very useful thing to have around, especially if you're working with magnets or different magnetic components like inductors or transformers. It'll help identify north and south poles, as well as locate different magnetic components on circuit boards, and it will also tell you if they're working or not. The addition of the little speaker inside of the magnetometer is also a great thing if you can get it accomplished. It allows you to hear different frequencies, and it helps determine how fast a magnetic field might be shifting inside of a different component. Well, I had a lot of fun building these, and I will continue to have a lot of fun exploring different magnetic fields and components in ways that I haven't before. I encourage you to build one of these. As I said, they're a very useful tool. I hope you enjoyed this video, and as always, stay tuned for more.